Good morning and welcome to Radio Friends on Wednesday, January the 2nd, 2019.
Wow.
Can you believe that?
No.
2019 now.
What is going on?
That's hard to believe. It's going to take me 3 or 4 months to write the checks correct. I'll still be putting 18 on it.
I will too.
Joy Sweeney is with us, Counsel for a Drug-Free Youth. Good to have you, Joy, and Happy New Year to you.
Happy New Year to you too, Paul.
You know, you are a lady who works very, very hard to help young people stay away from drugs or kick the habit if they have experimented with drugs.
Absolutely.
You've been involved with this for a long time, and I know in talking with you that this is something that you feel very strongly about.
Well, I've seen how it can destroy families and destroy lives, and it's just so sad when that happens. And so anything that I can do to help protect our young people from ever getting started, and, you know, I mean, Ben Franklin said it best, an ounce of prevention is worth a pound of cure.
Yeah.
It's so much easier to stop on the front end than it is to go through rehab and treatment and rehab and, you know, fall back into it and go back to another rehab. I know people that have been to rehab 12 different times and still struggle every single day in recovery.
Now, you have been on with us for a while, but I think it was last year, year before last, you were telling us, giving us some statistics about the age of young people who experiment for the first time with drugs.
Oh, well, I mean, in our baseline panels, we hear about kiddos that have had drugs as young as 5 years old. But the average age, so that's not the oldest or that's not the youngest, the average age is about 13 years old in central Missouri.
13 years of age. Experimenting with drugs. What kind of drugs are
mostly
you talking about?
Alcohol, marijuana. Those are the two that most of them are using. All the kids now think tobacco is, you know, oh, you wouldn't touch tobacco. Although with the vaping and the juuling, that's all coming back, and they don't even realize that there's nicotine in there. So that's a whole nother battle that we've just had to start to fight in the last 3 years.
We were talking about the fact that when someone experiments with drugs or use drugs at an early age, it affects the brain in a different way than an older person.
Absolutely. It rewires their brain so that they think they need that drug. And that's their brain thinks that it can't function without that drug. And the younger you start, the more likely you are to become addicted to alcohol, to marijuana, to nicotine, to all of those things. And the manufacturers know this. I mean, the tobacco companies even said it, and we have videotapes of their conference rooms where they're like, yes, we need to target our young people because then we'll have lifelong customers. We'll have customers for 50 years instead of just 10 years. And so that's what they want. And they know that it shortens lifespan. They know that it kills people, especially now. We all know this because of 50 years of education that we've been able to provide to people. But it still doesn't stop people that are addicted.
Is there hope for someone who is addicted at a very young age? Is there hope that if they kick the habit, they're able to stay off of that? Does the brain reset itself, or is it something that you're going to have to deal with for the rest of your life?
Well, I mean, and again, you have to talk to people in recovery, in long-term recovery. I think recovery is possible, as we've talked about on this show. I used to be addicted to alcohol, and recovery is possible. You can stop, and you can stop, you know, forever. There are people that are addicted to marijuana. There are people that are addicted to opioids. It depends on the drug, and depends on your support system, depends on the help that you have in your life. There are people that we know that they can't smoke cigarettes, and yet they continue to do so. So, I mean, it really depends. It's not a given, and there is no foolproof recovery method that there is out there. That person would be very wealthy if there was.
Yeah.
But yes, recovery is possible. Treatment is good. Prevention is the best.
How does someone know if they are actually addicted?
Well, if it's something that you can't stop doing. if you wake up every day and all you want to do or all you can think about is that drug or that substance. And, you know, when I say I was an alcoholic, no, that's not how I was towards alcohol. However, when I drank, I did not just drink because it tasted good. I drank to get drunk. And so that is basically what we call nowadays binge drinking. Again.
But you were much, much younger at that time.
It was over, it's almost 30 years ago. Yes.
Yeah.
Ancient. Well, you know, it was a whole other lifetime ago.
Right, exactly. I was talking years ago, 30, 35 years ago, I used to smoke pot.
Yeah.
And all, and I used to, I mean, I used to really smoke pot a lot. And then all at once, maybe it's more than 30 years ago, but all at once I decided I don't want to do this anymore.
Right.
And I haven't touched it for 30, 35 years, maybe 40 years. I can't remember, but it's been a long time.
Right.
How was I able to just stop at that point? And I have no desire whatsoever.
Well, and that's the, I mean, that's basically what I did too. I mean, I actually made a promise to God when my son got sick that if I never drank again, that he would live. And he did live, and I've never drank again.
Yeah.
So,
yeah.
I mean, that was my story. But, you know, we find things as our brains mature, as we get older, we find things that in life that are more important to us. And as our values change, and as we see what we value in life, we can make those decisions. And that's why when you're younger, making those decisions are so hard because the prefrontal cortex has not been fully developed.
Yeah.
And that's the part where the maturation and the rational decision-making, critical thinking skills all come into play. And when you're young, you don't have all of those skills, and therefore you make decisions that really hurt you for the rest of your life.
You will go to schools and organizations and talk to folks about this?
All the time, every day, yes.
If people want to have you come by, what do you do? What do they need to do?
All they need to do is get a hold of us at Council for Drug Free Youth. The number is 573-636-2411, or they can go to our website, www.jccdfy.org.
Okay, we've got about 30 seconds left. What do you see for the future? Do you have hope for the future?
I'm very hopeful for the future. I hope that our new marijuana laws don't provide too much access to people, and that we implement rules and policies that protect our children especially.
Okay. I know that's what you're most concerned about are the kids.
Absolutely.
All right. Joy Sweeney, thank you so much. You're a delightful lady to visit with. And I hope you'll come back again. Don't stay away for a year.
I'll try not to. Right. A pleasure to be here, Paul. Thank you.
All right, thank you, and Happy New Year to you.
Happy New Year.
We're out of time for today. Tomorrow, we're going to talk about trips and what they have going on. If there's something you would like to hear or see, I'd love to hear from you. Drop me an email. That's pepperp@missouri.edu. Have yourself a nice day, and Happy New Year.